Again. Can you scroll? It is September 17, 2020, and we're here at the Deuk Spine Institute, the Surgery Center of Vieira. It's a partnership between the two companies. The Surgery Center is where we do our surgeries, and Deuk Spine is where we see our patients in clinic. And today we're going to be broadcasting live spine surgery. Specifically, we're doing a Deuk laser disc repair. This is a back surgery that involves the endoscopic spine surgery. And what we're operating on is a herniated disc. Our patient has several herniated discs in her back, but one in particular we think is causing most of her symptoms. So she's having that one disc fixed today. To fix the disc, we have to go through the back through a little incision that's about 7 millimeters, and we do it all endoscopically. So there's no quote-unquote open surgery, traditional surgery. This surgery is being done here at Deuk Spine Institute, and it's unique because we discovered the surgery and the technique. Good morning. Can you hear me? We're gonna get started. All right, for those of you who have never watched a Deuk laser disc repair spine surgery, the patients, when we do it in the back, they're always awake in the beginning. I need their cooperation. You're gonna feel a little stick and burn. That's just the numbing medicine going in, okay? All right. Yeah, don't move. If you're having pain, just let me know and I'll give you more numbing medicine. She's fine. I just don't want her coming off the table. All of our patients are strapped down to the operating table. Unfortunately, this injection right now is a little uncomfortable for most patients. All right, we injected 7 cc's of local. So we're going to put the patient to sleep shortly, but I need her help in the very beginning. Okay. Now the surgery is unique from other spine surgeries in that it's done transforaminally. What does that mean? It means we go through the foramen. Trans means across, foramen, we're referring to the neuroforamen. And a transforaminal approach to a spine problem is an approach that was developed initially by pain management doctors who would put in steroids into the spine. Let's get a shot. And they do what's called a transforaminal lumbar epidural steroid injection. And they do that with a spinal needle or a type of needle that would go in the foramen and put steroid medicine. Oh, I know something's wrong. I can see that. Let's call Monica, please. So what's wrong right now is our x-ray image is not coming up. And the way we do the surgery is we use an x-ray to see where the spine is. And not just see where the spine is, but to go to the right place in the spine, okay? So the spine has many joints, many discs, many bones. And the way the spine is structured, you can think of it as like little Legos. Each vertebrae, which is the specific discrete unit in the spine of bone that makes up the spine, each vertebrae has a very complex structure. And what I mean by complex structure is that it has a lot of branches and arms to each vertebrae. It has different structural components that are determined by the function of that vertebrae in that specific location. So the vertebrae is three-dimensional. And they basically stack on top of each other, but to get to the disc through the foramen, you have to come from the side. So that's one thing that's very different about the surgery we do here at Deuk Spine Institute that's approach to the spine that's novel, it's new. It's not something other spine surgeons are used to doing. Spine surgeons are taught to come to the spine through the middle, the center of the back, just dead center. And once they hit the spine, they first have to peel the muscles off the spine. And then once they peel the muscles off the spine, they have to make holes in the bone of the spine just to get down to where the nerves and the disc are. Those holes we call laminotomy, laminectomy, foraminotomy, partial facetectomy. Okay? Those are basically the procedures. Well, those holes that are made surgically in the spine are going to... Have you figured it out or not? What's going on with Monica?
Right here.
Hey, okay, good. Those holes that are made surgically in the spine so that the surgeon can access the pinched nerve, access the disc, those holes are bad for the patient. They're not good, okay? They're not good for you, the patient. But they're an accepted collateral damage because the surgeons don't know any other way to get to the spine other than through the midline. So you, the patient, having back surgery, you're paying the price for their lack of education, their lack of knowledge, their lack of experience in more advanced, more sophisticated treatments. That's the simplest way of putting it. The collateral damage they create during the surgery is universally accepted by spine surgeons because that's all that 99% of spine surgeons know how to do. And so, unfortunately, you, the patient, suffer the consequence because now you've had bone taken out of your vertebrae and now it's going to wobble around more and cause more pain. So a doctor, Parvis Cambin, was the first spine surgeon to figure out that surgery, not just injections, but surgery could be done through the lumbar foramen if you had the right equipment to do it. Very smart man. And of course, for years, he started developing the right equipment himself. He started having things made from metal, shaped. And he developed a tubular retractor system that could be used to access the disc through the foramen. So Dr. Cambin, Parvis Cambin, was the first to do that. And as a result of his work, doctors like Dr. Alfred Bonatti of the Bonatti Spine Institute, they learned that transforaminal technique many, many years ago. And they brought it to the world. The Bonatti Spine Institute in Florida, one of the first that did endoscopic surgery. Unfortunately, Dr. Bonatti did not continue in the path of transforaminal approach. He went to do endoscopic surgery, but through the normal translaminar approach, transfacet approach, which is what everyone else does. It means he has to remove bone from the lamina, called a laminotomy, and he has to remove bone from the facet, called a partial facetectomy. It's the facet removing bone that's really the biggest problem, because once you start removing the bone from a joint, the joint is going to become unstable. I don't care how many people tell you it doesn't become unstable. Of course it becomes unstable. If you took half of your knee out, there's definitely going to be a change in the way you're walking. And over time, that joint's going to wear out even worse, and you're going to have pain, swelling, you're going to have ligament thickening, meniscal injuries. The facet joint is a weight-bearing joint, and it's a diarthrodial joint. It has cartilaginous surfaces. Point is, you can't take half your knee out, you can't take half your elbow out, you can't take half your shoulder out and not have consequences. But that's what they do with normal spine surgery. With microdiscectomy, for example, the spine surgeon takes out half of your facet joint. Some of them take more than half. Actually, many of them take more than half because their technique is not good. It's a tough surgery to do. So the vast majority of people in the world are going to have a microdiscectomy for a herniated disc with leg pain. We don't do microdiscectomies anymore at Duke Spine because they take out the bone. And we don't want to destabilize the spine. So we go transforaminal. which means we go through a natural hole. All right, let's go lateral, please. What was the problem? Well, so you guys just restarted the fluoro and it's working? I always get nervous when the fluoro doesn't work because it's not that we don't have backup fluoro. We do. We have four of these things. The problem is that the repairs are very expensive. Are you awake?
Yeah.
All right. All right. I think we need to be a little bit lower. Yeah. But I'm going through the old area. It shouldn't be too bad. Are you uncomfortable or comfortable? You don't like that? All right. I injected two more cc's. You're doing fantastic, by the way. You are. I've done this a couple of times, and I'm telling you, you're doing a great job. All right, so we need to, I'm going to be talking to my team and our audience, okay? All right. We need to get that lined up. Now we can see at the bottom of the spine, there's the tailbone. It looks like an ice cream cone. That's the sacrum. Then we have our first disc above that. It's the L5-S1 disc. That's better, but I think we need to wag a slight amount. See that inferior end plate of L4? I want to get it so it's not like a circle or an oval. I want to get it flat across. We want to line our fluoro machine up so that we're looking straight down the disc base. I don't know. Maybe that's better. I think that's better, right? It looks like the pedicles are lined up. It's darker because the top of the iliac crest, which is corticated bone, is going right through the L4-5 disc base, which it normally does anyway. So that looks good. Let's lock it down. I'm going to walk over to my MRI again and look at it just to make sure we're operating at the right level. You know, there's five discs down here in the lumbar region. Other way. Yeah, 5-1 is totally collapsed. But we're not treating L5-S1. We're treating L4-5. So that looks pretty good. Any questions from our audience, Sean?
None so far.
All right. Are you comfortable? All right. Well, just let me know if you're uncomfortable, okay? All right. Shot? When I say shot, what I'm doing is taking a picture, just so you know. Shot? Huh? Shot? Who has to have a smile, you or me? You want me to have a smile? Oh, all right. For you, I'll do that. Jordan, I need a shot. Yeah. For you, I'll have a smile, okay? Because you asked me to have a smile. Normally, I'm not the smiling type. I'm just kidding. That was a joke.
We have a question.
Yes.
One of our viewers is wondering, does a disc bulge result in an annular tear, or does it have to be herniated to be torn?
Shot. That's a great question. So to answer your question, a disc bulge is a herniated disc, huh? I think I'm a little bit lateral to where I need to be and too superior. A disc bulge, just for the record, there, unfortunately, Sean, are you okay? There are a lot of different names for a problem with the disc. Sean? And I do cover this sometimes during the surgery, but there's a lot of different names for disc problems. And those different names include bulging disc, herniated disc, ruptured disc, slip disc, protruding disc, extruded disc. The list goes on and on and on. In the end, they're all exactly the same thing. It's just different degrees. All right, let's get an AP. So all of those terms related to the disc are exactly the same except for one. The one term that is not the same is called discitis. And discitis is inflammation of the disc itself, really bad inflammation, okay? And that inflammation of the disc comes from, let's go lateral. That inflammation of the disc, most of the time, comes from an infection of the disc. And that is not the same as the other disc problems that you hear about, like herniated disc, bulging disc, ruptured disc, slip disc, extruded disc, etc. All the disc problems that occur for the same exact reason. Sean? And that reason is a tear in the containment system of the disc called the annulus fibrosus. And because of that tear, the jelly in the center of the disc, Sean? The jelly in the center of the disc actually squeezes out through the tear in the back of the disc. Sean? Now, herniated disc can happen either in the front of the disc, the back of the disc, or the sides of the disc, okay? Anywhere around the disc, Sean? The disc is a roundish oval-shaped structure, okay, Sean? And so the annular tears and disc herniations can occur front, back, or side. But what's important to remember is that it's only the tears in the back of the disc that are painful, okay? AP, why is that? I've gone over this before, but it's an important point, and most every spine surgeon out there doesn't even know this. Literally, 99.99% of spine surgeons have no clue about this. But the nerves that go to the back of the disc are different than the nerves that go to the side and the front. They come from a very special place in the brain. Basically, they're connected to a special place in the brain, lateral. That's perfect, by the way. You can see the needle that's coming in the foramen, low. So the nerves that are in the back of the disc are a type of nerve classified as somatic afferent, SA nerves, SA. Look it up, somatic afferent. Somatic afferent nerves go to a place in the brain that perceives pain, but it tells the person exactly where the pain comes from. You see? Exactly where the pain. So they know it's their lower back. Whereas the other parts of the disc, the side and front of the disc, are innervated. They have nerve fibers there that come from, that project to parts of the brain that don't localize to specific parts of the body. They're just kind of vague sensations of discomfort. So, at most, by the way, at most vague sensations of discomfort, okay? They go to other parts of the brain. I'm not going to get into the details. But the fibers from the back of the disc go to the primary somatosensory cortex. Google that, primary somatosensory cortex. All right, let's go south just like a half inch, just to make sure we're at L4-5 before we get started. Because I think we're at L4-5. That's the disc we're fixing today, right, guys? L4-5, everybody in agreement? And the L5-S1 is the one below that. It's totally collapsed, but we're not operating on that. She also has a herniation at L3-4, but we're not operating on that. The one that's on the right side hitting the right nerve is the L4-5. So that's the only one we're fixing today. Are you comfortable? Do you normally get back pain? Well, but I mean, before you came and saw me, did you ever have back pain in your back, or was it just your leg? Yeah, I'm just asking, do you have back pain from this bad disc, or is it just leg pain? Oh, you have back and leg, right? Okay. What does your rose symbolize, by the way? You have a tattoo of a rose with a blue butterfly. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. I'm just curious why you picked a rose. All right. Fair enough. It's a pretty tattoo. We're going to get you to sleep in a minute, okay? But I need to do a quick test. Are you comfortable? How bad is that?
That's about an 8.
Not higher?
Oh.
The highest it went is an 8?
Well, I could do a 10.
Okay, all right, 10. Is that where you typically get your back pain?
Yep.
All right, the good news is we found your painful disc.
Well,
and by the time you wake up, it'll be gone.
Okay.
It won't be painful anymore. The disc won't be gone. The pain will be gone.
Okay.
The disc will still be there. We're just going to repair it. The surgery we're about to do is a surgery we discovered here at Deuk Spine Institute. Nobody else has ever done anything even close. It's a repair of that tear in the back of the disc, the annular tear. So spine surgery up to this point doesn't have a procedure that repairs the annular tear. I created that procedure and we published it in 2012. It's called the Deuk Laser Disc Repair. All other spine surgeries are removal of herniations, fusing of bones together, instrumentation, correction of alignment, decompression. But there is no procedure in the world that anyone's ever done which repairs and debridement of the annular tear. It's called an annular debridement of the annular tear. And we're the first people to discover it, to use it, and to publish it. So why is that important? Well, it's important because nobody else knows how to do this procedure that you're watching. Why is that important? It's important because this is the procedure to fix the back pain from a herniated disc. Now, a fusion would work too. If we were to clean that whole disc out and put a cage in there, that would take her pain away. So the fusion would be an alternative procedure. But this patient doesn't want a fusion, and most people don't. There's no need for it, because what you're about to watch is the new procedure that's going to take over spinal fusions. But it's unfortunately only done here. Why am I telling you this? For a lot of reasons. One of them is we need to train more surgeons to do this procedure. But there's a lot of forces acting against us. One of them is our training institute is in a place that people don't want to live. So they don't want to come spend a year here. We're in Brevard County, Florida. Personally, I like Brevard County. We got nice beaches. But even Cam here, who's assisting me, is going to leave someday and go to a big city. All right? So there's the location. It's hard to get surgeons to come live here. It takes a special kind of person to want to live in an area like this, okay? Another reason is surgeons have to take a whole year out of their life to learn these surgeries, at least a year. So surgeons don't want to do that, and I don't pay them very well. I chuckle about it, but surgeons want to be paid a lot of money, and I don't have a lot of money to pay surgeons, so that's going to be an issue. And third of all, surgeons really believe when they're done with their training that they know everything. Shot? So it's hard to tell a surgeon they don't know everything important. They all think they know everything important. It's funny. Just to give you a reference point, I trained at the University of Florida in Gainesville. I was valedictorian in my medical school class. Why is that important? It's important because as the valedictorian, you get to choose where to go for your neurosurgery training. They don't tell you where to go. You tell them where you're going. And I interviewed at places like Harvard, Johns Hopkins, Columbia, the Barrow Neurological Institute. I interviewed at the top neurosurgery training programs because I had that ability to do that because of my performance in medical school being number one at USC and my research, publications, things like that, okay? My great personality, my handsome charismatic smile, my feathered hairdo. Just kidding about the last ones. But the important thing is I could choose where to go. So I chose the best training, you know? Honestly, who wants to live in Gainesville, Florida? There's really nothing there. It's a college town. But for 7 years, I sacrificed my fun and enjoyment, and instead I just learned how to be one of the best neurosurgeons in the country. Okay? So to give you a reference point, there's 100 neurosurgery training programs. And Gainesville was one of the top three at the time. Incision? So the difference in training is dramatic, depending on where you go. And it's important, if you want to be a top surgeon, you go to the one of the top 10 or 15 or 20 training programs. Okay? The bottom 80 training programs suck really bad. Sorry, but they do. They're still accredited because we need neurosurgeons, but they suck. And the training you get there is terrible. So I would get neurosurgeons applying to come and work for me from some of these not as good training programs. And I would tell them, listen, the first thing we're going to do the first year is I'm going to teach you how to do spine surgery the right way. And their response was always, I already know how to do spine surgery the right way. And my response was, no, you don't. No, you don't. Trust me, you don't. And of course, I would never hire them because they don't want to learn anything new. They think they know everything. All of this you're watching me do right now, I didn't learn at Chan's Hospital in Gainesville, even though it was a top program. They didn't even know about this technology. I had to learn this from the Koreans in South Korea. I had to learn this overseas in Europe, in Germany and Great Britain. There was one doctor. I think he's retired now. And then in Phoenix, Arizona, there was a doctor. But there was only a few in the world that know how to do this approach. So what I'm getting at is, unfortunately, the reason why there's not more doctors doing this surgery is a lot of reasons. I could go on for hours talking about those reasons. Some of them have to do with the companies that the alternative surgery, I already told you, is a fusion. I can feel the herniation, by the way, right here. I'm pushing against it. I'm going to push it back into the disc. But I know you have a question, Sean. I'm going to get to it in just a minute. But I'm trying to explain to the audience why this surgery is not done more commonly everywhere. And a big part of it is not just that the surgeons don't have access to learn it in their training programs. A big part of it is that the reimbursement for this is a lot less than a fusion. So I make a lot more money doing a fusion than I do this surgery. So, and that goes true for everybody. So the surgeons don't want to do a procedure that doesn't pay that well. That's the God's honest truth. They need to make money and pay their bills. And they don't want to, I need a mallet. They don't want to do this procedure because it doesn't pay very well. No. Come on, Cam. You got to put an instrument in the surgeon's hand the way he wants to use it. I want the hammer. Okay, so let's do that. Shot. What does this teach you? I hope it does. So there's a lot of forces in play right now that go against surgeons doing this kind of surgery. The most important, they don't even know it exists because they've never seen it. They don't watch the videos like you do. They're not sitting in front of their computer going, wow, this is amazing. They're out there in clinic, you know, doing patient care, or the hospital doing patient care. So they don't have time to learn this kind of stuff. Jeez, come on, Cam. 3D, man, we got to get that 3D brain working. You want to be a surgeon, you have to think three-dimensionally. Okay, shot. So what I'm doing is I'm advancing the tubular dilator, shot. So I can do the surgery through a tiny little tube. But I'm doing it in a safe way. I advance the tube over the dilator. This is the dilator. I'll show it to you. And then I'll take the question. So this dilator looks like a long pencil that's made out of metal. Has a tapered tip. It goes over the guide wire and runs down the guide wire. So it spreads the muscle tissue open. Now it doesn't cut the muscles. It just spreads it open. There's a difference between cutting and spreading, right? Spreading, you're moving something away. You're just pushing it away. Cutting, you're actually cutting it to get it to move away. With open surgeries, the surgeons are cutting your tissues. They're cutting, you know, things and moving them away. Whereas with this endoscopic surgery, you're not cutting anything. You're just, except for the skin. Of course, we have to cut the skin. But besides the skin, everything else is spread apart. It's not cut. So the tissue heals much faster because there's very little trauma during endoscopic surgery. You've all, many of you have all seen endoscopic shoulder surgery, knee surgery. That's been around for, you know, 40, 50 years. But nobody's really seen endoscopic spine surgery because it's a newer technology. And we've been doing it here for 16 years at Deuk Spine. Actually, 15 years. I apologize. It's hard to keep track of the years. But all right, you have a question, I'm sure, more than one.
We just have a viewer who's wondering why you do the discogram when the patient is still awake.
Why do we do the discogram when the patient's still awake? Because the discogram tells us, with the patient awake, whether they're experiencing their typical pain. It tells me if the result is going to be good or not. You know, we want to verify that we're doing the right thing for the patient. I don't want to do an annular debridement on a patient who doesn't have pain at the disc we're about to operate on. So it's a confirmatory test. It confirms that this disc is the cause of their pain. There's no other way to do it other than the discogram. So there's no test in medicine or in the world available except for a discogram to confirm 100% that a spinal disc herniation is causing a patient's back pain. You see, the great dilemma in curing back pain is that the doctor doesn't know where the back pain comes from. And they have a name for it. It's called, ooh, look at that herniation. It's called non-specific back pain. Look it up. You'll see lots of things written about it. Non-specific back pain means we have no freaking clue where this pain's coming from. What I've discovered in my practice is that there's no such thing as non-specific back pain. It's really a diagnosis made when the doctor doesn't have the right training, tools, experience to know, stop, what's wrong. Okay, so they call it non-specific. It's kind of like when I go online and I voice my opinion about something, and then people that don't agree with me, they call me an asshole. I'm not really an asshole, but to them I am. So back pain that you can't figure out what's causing it becomes nonspecific, right? The doctor blames the diagnosis on something they don't understand, and that's their way of saying it. All right, so take a look here. Let's turn the light on for a second. I'm going to show you the first real piece of herniation. Can you guys see this here, Sean?
Yes, we can.
Can you all see that? Zoom in on it so everyone can see it. Move the light on it. There we go. Is that better? Right there?
Yes.
Yeah. So what is this instrument? Look at that. I put this grabber through the endoscope into the disc, and I can actually grab out pieces of herniation like that. Okay, so that was part of a herniation that was pushing on her nerve. So non-specific back pain is a diagnosis of the doctor saying, I have no clue what's wrong. And the reality is that if you understand the sources of back pain, what they are, then you know. Then if you kind of step back and you say, all right, this has happened before, what was the reason? And it turns out for me, the reason was that when the power goes out from the electric company and then comes back on, the sequence of power, repowering, has to be a specific sequence. It has to first repower the air compressor, which is outside, and then it has to repower the air handler, which is that blower fan inside. Now, those are the two things that they install when they put an air conditioner in, right? They put a blower or air handler on the inside, and they put a compressor outside. So what I had to do was actually turn off the power to both and then repower them in a sequence, first outside, then inside. And guess what? It worked. But you know, before I understood that, before I had knowledge of the causes and the solution, how to fix it, It was just like, I have no clue what's wrong, right? So get the air conditioner guy to come out here. Well, the air conditioner guy goes through a logical step-by-step process to diagnose what's wrong. And same thing happens for back pain. Most doctors are like me when I don't know anything about my air conditioning system. They're clueless. And to them, back pain is just a black box. And that's the way it's been for eternity, since the beginning of time. But now, with people like me at Deuk Spine Institute and Dr. Patel, we can diagnose the actual cause because we have a lot of experience, 1,000, 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 patients now that have had back pain, and we know exactly what's causing their pain. We may not be able to tell you on an MRI, we won't, but we can tell you with an MRI, a physical exam, and some diagnostic injection sometimes what's causing the back pain. But for the most part, we're pretty darn good at figuring it out. Now, there are other doctors like us in the world, but there's not many of them. What needs to change is we need all the doctors in the world to know what causes back pain and how to diagnose it properly and then how to treat it properly. Now, the treatment is real simple. Once you know the diagnosis, you can treat it easily. In this particular patient, her back pain is coming from this herniated disc, specifically not the herniation, but the annular tear. And that's one of my contributions to medicine, is basically figuring out that it's the annular tear in the back of the disc, not the side, not the front, but the back, that's the source of discogenic back pain. And now I've also figured out a way to fix it, because thanks to the Koreans and the German and the British doctor and the American doctor, surgeon, they've all taught me endoscopic surgery. I've taken that and I've applied what I learned about pain to this technique, and I've developed a brand new technique that cures pain. So someday we'll be able to cure back pain around the world, as long as the doctors understand the cause and are able to make the right diagnosis and then provide the right treatment. Making that happen is going to take hundreds of millions of dollars that I don't have, and a lot of public awareness, training, new facilities, new equipment purchase, investment by hospitals, et cetera, et cetera. There has to be a huge change that occurs, not just with an exchange of knowledge and understanding, but also with literally buying fluoro machines and endoscopic tubes and lasers and laser fibers. The blue thing is the laser fiber, by the way. And what I'm doing is I'm debriding the annular tear and I'm removing the interposed herniation. So I hope I answered the original question, which was, you know, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? And the first thing that happens in all disc herniations, all of them, is the annular tear. It is number one, the first thing that happens. You can't have a disc herniation, you can't have a disc bulge, you can't have an extrusion, you can't have a slip disc, prolapse disc, ruptured disc, whatever you want to call it, you can't have it without an annular tear first. So before you ask the next question, I'll ask a trivia question. I'm going to ask Cam, see if he was paying attention. I have to start pimping Cam. Okay, that's what we call it in the business, pimping. It sounds horrible, but what it means, and I didn't make this term up, okay, so don't give me a bunch of hate mail. Pimping in medicine means asking the students questions, you know, see how much knowledge they have, see if they're paying attention to what you're talking about. You know, surgeons and teachers don't want to teach their class if the students aren't paying attention and learning. So, Cam,
yes, sir.
How many annular tears have I fixed in the front of a disc?
We're all on the back, sir.
How many? So zero. How many on the side of a disc?
Zero.
You're right. So Cam was paying attention. So he's still good in my eyes. He keeps his job today. That's the pressure we have to deal with in residency. You never know when the chairman is going to get so angry with you, he's going to fire you. I had a resident in neurosurgery who got fired 3 times during his 7-year residency in neurosurgery at University of Florida. And I'll tell you his name. His name was Wesley Fonts. Look him up on Google. The only reason I say that is because Wesley was a true piece of garbage as a human being. I'm sorry. But he was incredibly callous, hateful, spiteful. He hated people. He became a neurosurgeon because I guess it was a pride thing or a money thing, but he certainly doesn't have any compassion. Maybe Wesley's learned something in the last 16 years since I last saw him, but he was a complete usual dirtbag of a doctor, which many of you have experienced, that just don't care about you. Anyway, so I have no problem mentioning his name. Fired 3 times. I will not say who did this, but one of our neurosurgery residents, senior to me, opened up the wrong side of a patient's head to take out a brain tumor. And when the chairman came in the room and couldn't find the brain tumor, he went back to the wall and looked at the MRI and said, "We've opened the wrong side of the head." That was a resident's fault, and I won't tell you who the resident was. Okay, but I can tell you they were fired. Yeah, I had never done that, folks. Why? Because I actually care about people. I don't want to ever do something to harm somebody intentionally, so I'm very, very cautious about what's called the timeout, which is where we actually sit down before we even touch the patient. We make sure we're operating on the right place, the right side, the right level. Unfortunately, some people think that's a joke and they don't take it seriously and they don't do it properly. And of course, who suffers? The patient. So I don't believe that that we should be allowed to make mistakes like that without paying a high price. Apparently the chairman agreed, but of course that resident did finish this training and he's out in the world taking care of people. That's just one example of some of the sloppy medical care that I've witnessed. I could go on and tell you more stories, but I'll probably get more hate mail as a result. But you should be aware. The public needs to be aware that there are bad doctors out there. There are bad doctors. And honestly, I believe bad people make bad doctors. I think bad people make bad doctors.
We have a question.
Yep.
One of our viewers is wondering, do you offer a fellowship to teach DLDR, and why aren't more surgeons adopting it?
Yeah, so that's what we were talking about earlier. The question from our viewer was, do you offer a fellowship to teach surgeons how to do this surgery? The answer is yes, we do. And why haven't more surgeons, you know, come and trained? And it was kind of the reasons I was talking about at the beginning of the surgery. If you hit rewind, you'll hear them. But number one, we're not in a sexy place to live. Duke Spine Institute is in what I think is an amazing place to live, which is the Space Coast of Florida. We're on the east coast of Florida, right in the middle, like just directly east of Orlando, okay? It's a little bit rural, okay? We don't have skyscrapers. We don't have traffic. We don't have smog. We have kind of a sleepy little town full of, you know, rocket scientists and a neurosurgeon or two, and that's about it. We don't have a lot of action here. We have stars at night in the sky. We have clean air. We have the beaches that are perfect and beautiful, called Cocoa Beach. And but a lot of people want to be in the city. They don't want to come here and spend a year of their life learning this technique. The second reason is there's no punishment for these surgeons for doing the kind of surgeries they do, for not knowing the latest and best. There's no downside, you understand? If you're a neurosurgeon in Chicago and you're doing fusions all day long on patients instead of this surgery, there's no downside because the guy across the street's doing the same thing. And the other surgeons in the hospital are doing the same thing, you understand? So, oh, look at that herniation right there. Isn't that amazing? It's just kind of squeezed out from the annular tear right there. Look at that. So cool. Okay, that's a herniation. There it goes. It's floating up now. It's coming out of the tube. Okay, we'll follow it up. Pretty neat. Anyway, point is, I guess if you live in a town where every man beats his wife every night, then beating your wife every night is okay, right? But it's not. That's the whole point. But until people figure out it's not okay, it's not going to change. And so right now, people haven't figured it out, right? We didn't let women vote in this country. We didn't let blacks vote in this country. We've discriminated. Basically, it's all about what's called culture, which is shared beliefs. It's what people believe. It's what they share, right? When you go to a street light and it's red, we all know you're supposed to stop. We share that belief. Stopping at a red light is good. It's the right thing to do. But in neurosurgery and spine surgery, orthopedic surgery, they don't know anything about this procedure. They don't know that this is better. They don't know that this exists. They don't know this is available. And so without even knowing, how could they be expected to act on it, right? And I've actually gone to the big meetings and given talks. I've published papers. And guess what? To no avail. It doesn't make a stinking bit of difference. So I'm kind of thinking to myself, I'm wasting my time trying to get the word out to these surgeons because they don't pay attention. And I'm going to tell you right now, many of them go to the meetings and they heard me talk. They know about these procedures. They choose not to do anything about it. They don't want to learn it. Number one, they make more money doing fusions. Number two, if you're doing fusions, there's something that happens that you probably don't know about. And that is the companies that make the screws and rods, they make literally about $10,000 to $20,000, $30,000 a surgery, okay, a fusion. Now, think about that. Average of about $25,000 in implants, metal implants per fusion surgery. And there are 1 million fusion surgeries done in the United States every year. So multiply 1 million times 25,000. And that gives you an idea of the value of implants, that screws, rods, cages, the monetary value to companies that control marketing. They control TV commercials. They control radio commercials. They control the training of surgeons at the universities. They literally are in the operating room with the surgeons as they're learning how to do surgery. They take them out for steak dinners. They buy them beers. They become buddy-buddy. It's a culture. It's a cultural thing. And when those surgeons get out of their training, they go and they do fusions. I'm out of irrigation, it looks like, or something. No? Maybe? I don't know. Is it still going? Or we have irrigation? All right, good. Because I'm seeing a lot of debris and a lot of bubbles. So it looks like it's getting slower or something. Just keep an eye on it. So I'm giving you the God's honest truth as to why our system is broken and why the surgery is not more prevalent. So I decided, screw the surgeons. I'm not going to train them. I'm not going to train them unless they come to me, right? I'm not going to go out begging them to learn this technology. That's not going to happen, okay? You can criticize me for not begging surgeons to learn this technology, but I'm not going to do that. So what I decided to do instead was to educate the public. There's something called direct-to-consumer. What that means is, who cares about their back pain more than somebody having back pain? And those are the people that really need to learn about what's available, what's not available, what's good, what's bad. So that's what I've decided is I'm going to go teach the people that want to learn. And surgeons don't want to learn, unfortunately. They think they know everything. They have this belief that they come out of training and they're good. They got it. We're good. We're done. But that's not the case. The truth is they don't know very much at all. And they know how to cut and how to sew, and they know how to bipolar, and they know how to stop bleeding and stuff like that, but they don't know how to do the latest, most advanced surgeries in the world. So that's why I'm trying to teach the public with these broadcasts. How are we doing, guys? We have enough irrigation? I'm almost done. I need about 30 seconds. Did I answer that question?
I believe so.
So we got some special stuff today. This is our only surgery for today. And we're going to be doing a really interesting new thing. We're going to do a question-answer session with me and Sean. Sean is going to be asking me questions. We're also going to take questions from our audience. We're going to do a live stream. Sean, why don't you tell them about it? What time is it right now? It's 9:40. We're going to start this in at 10:30 today, 10:30 Eastern Standard Time, 10:30. Deuk's Spine Institute will broadcast a live, real-time question-answer for the audience. Anybody that wants to ask a question during the session, And we're going to use our slide presentation with some pictures to answer the questions. Okay, so we're going to use some visual aids to answer the questions that the audience has. And that'll be our first broadcast. Sean, go ahead and tell our audience about that.
Yeah, so just join us in about 45 minutes after the surgery is complete. We're going to be going through a PowerPoint. It's just going to be a short webinar. We're going to explain the multiple causes of back pain and their treatment options. We'll have live Q&A in the chat, so if you have any questions about what we're discussing, you can ask and we'll answer them real time.
Huh? No, we're done. We're done. Did you already spike it? Oh, okay, just switch it then. That's fine. All right, so thank you, Sean. Now, for those of you that missed it, Tuesday, which was 2 days ago, we broadcasted a thoracic herniation patient. This patient had a thoracic disc herniation. They've had it for years. They had horrible pain in their thoracic spine. For the ladies, that pain was right around the bra strap area. And, you know, for the guys, the pain was literally between his shoulder blades. It came from a herniated disc in the thoracic spine. We did the Deuk laser disc repair. It was a T7-8 disc herniation. And that patient had 100% relief of his pain that he's had for 2.5 years since an accident. That patient was is in law enforcement. And he was in a plane, I guess. I don't know what they do. They track down. I'm not going to say what he does because I don't know. Maybe they track down drug dealers and, you know, capture them on speedboats or something. But he's a pilot. He's in the law enforcement. He had a situation where the plane was bouncing up and down really bad. I don't know why. But he herniated discs in his neck, lower back, and thoracic. So he's had laser surgery on his neck, thoracic, and lower back. The Deuk laser disc repair. This surgery you're watching now. And we did his thoracic yesterday, and his pain is 100% gone immediately after surgery. Incredible result. Great result. Very happy patient. And that video is online on Deuk Spine Institute. Now, Deuk Spine Institute offers an app for free. Whether you have an iPhone or an Android, you can download it. Download it on your computer. And you can access a lot of really valuable in content that we put on there. And you can also upload your MRI if you want us to look at it and tell you what's wrong with your back or your neck or your thoracic. Now remember, the MRI by itself won't tell us anything, but it's a starting point. We need to do an interview if we really want to know. There has to be a physical exam, okay? But an MRI is a very good starting point. That said, Deuk Spine also has a spine surgery support group on Facebook. You're welcome to join. Look up Spine Surgery Support Group. You don't have to have spine surgery to join. We just thought of a name that we thought people could remember and would be good. But basically, anyone with questions about the spine or anything, you can join that group. It's free, open to the public. All right, we're done. Laser off. What happened to Hazel? I thought she liked being in here. There's the nerve, by the way. And all the herniation is completely gone. So, any other questions right now before we wrap up surgery? I'll be in the conference room in a few minutes to answer questions you have, so go ahead and type them up. Scope off. I'm going to show you the incision, Sean, in just a second here. I think I'm going to need Dr. Patel to do a shot on my arm. I'm having a little tennis elbow. What's surprising is I haven't been playing tennis. My arm started hurting me because I've been lifting the go-karts for my son at the racetrack. Arius is racing 2 classes in go-karting now. He races the professional engines, and then he races what's called the KA100 senior class. And he also races the rock engine. So really 3 types of engines in the United States. We were just talking to his agent yesterday about the World Championship coming up in November in Portugal, which we'll be going to. They use a different kind of engine over there, as well as different tire compound. So we need to get some more experience on that engine and tire compound. A little pressure. It turns out, oh, let's show our audience the incision here. See that there, Sean?
Yes, we can.
That's the whole spine surgery incision, guys and gals. Band-aid. Beautiful. All right. Any questions right now?
None currently.
Please don't, yeah. All right, I'll be over there shortly. I'm going to call the EBL 2 mil. No complication. DLDR, right, L4-5. Yeah, beautiful. Nice job, everyone. Great work today. See, I don't keep you all here that late, do I? Not every day, at least. Thanks, Dr. Arcos. All right, I'll be over in a minute. Okay, Dr. Deuk Majan here. I assume I'm broadcasting my voice, but I'm not sure. In the operating room, put a thumbs up if you guys can hear my voice. Give me a thumbs up. I can't see that. Is that a thumbs up? There we go. Okay, thumbs up. So Sean is not here. He must have run off to the little boy's room. But Dr. Deuk Majan here, just to wrap up this surgery. I guess we don't have any questions from the audience because our audience knows everything. But no, in all seriousness, this was a single level, that was the L4-5, right-sided Deuk laser disc repair. The patient was pretty typical in that she has chronic lower back pain right at the belt line in the center, and it radiates down, shoots down into her right leg. The MRI showed several herniations at L3-4, L4-5, L5-S1, but the one herniation that was on the right side, and it looked like it would definitely be causing back and leg pain, was the L4-5. So we treated it, but before I treated it, we did a discogram to confirm that it was indeed causing her back pain. And sure enough, she had 10 out of 10 pain. When I injected the dye without her knowing, she kind of arched her back. And she said, ow, so we knew for sure. And by the way, there's no way to fake that. When I inject that little bit of dye, the patient jumped off, you know, almost jumped off the table. She would have jumped off the table if she could. Point is, the discogram is the gold standard only test in the world that will tell you 100% for sure that someone's pain in their back or neck or thoracic is coming from a herniated disc. So I'm a big, big, big advocate for evocative discograms to confirm sources of back pain, neck pain, thoracic pain. And I'm just telling you all this because there are so many doctors out there that just blow off patients with chronic pain and tell them there's nothing that can be done. Well, don't listen to them. You can get it fixed. You just have to find the right doctor to fix it. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of them that know how to fix this problem in the year 2020 and before. I've been practicing as a neurosurgeon treating chronic back and neck pain for 22 years. And what I've seen in our medical system at the highest level, the very best doctors, doesn't matter where you go, there's this kind of belief that, you know, people with back pain, they're just going to have back pain the rest of their life. There's nothing that could be done. And I'll be honest with you, I think at least 50% of the doctors out there, they truly believe in their heart, because that's what they've been told and that's what they've seen, is that people with chronic back pain are kind of faking it. You know, they're just needy. They don't want to work. They want disability. They want empathy from their family members. Listen, I'm not making this up. I hear it. I heard it as a resident. I hear it from people. They all believe, the 50% of doctors, I'm picking a number. It's probably not 50. It's probably 51. But my point is that there's a lot of doctors that believe the patients are just kind of milking it with the back pain complaints. And I'm going to tell you why. They believe that because that's what they've been brought up to believe, okay? And because they don't know how to cure that pain. If you take a patient with back pain that's chronic, and you bring them and fix them as a doctor, and you witness that pain go away, you realize at that very moment that that patient wasn't faking it. And then you got to start wondering, how many other patients that I was told were faking it, maybe they really weren't faking it. Maybe they really did have back pain. And maybe I could have fixed it. And you know, that's a sobering thought for someone who actually cares about people, to know that you could have taken someone out of their pain and you didn't, because you were too arrogant in your belief that you knew what was going on when you really didn't know what was going on, all right? And so that's why this element of humility, being humble, is important to being a compassionate and effective caregiver in healthcare. You really have to understand that it doesn't matter how old you are, it doesn't matter how many years you've practiced, you're gonna see things that you won't understand. You really need to investigate and do your very best, okay? So I was very lucky in life that God blessed me and gave me the ability to help people and cure back pain and neck pain. Frankly, I don't know why he chose me. I would have been very happy just being a professional soccer player and, you know, I hate to say it, but having an easy life compared to what I've had to go through to make a living. But the truth is that I'm here for whatever reasons, and there it's not my control. I don't believe that I put myself here. I believe that God had a path for me. And here I am helping these people. And because of that, I also believe that God has plans for me to spread the word. Why is there a microphone in my hand? Why am I talking to you? Why am I recording these surgeries? Why are other people going to have an opportunity to learn from this? Those are questions that I really couldn't answer because it happened. And it's not like I woke up one day and said, this is what we're going to do because this is what I want to do. I believe that I was put here for this reason and that my job isn't done and that we're going to keep broadcasting, we're going to keep teaching, we're going to keep recording, and we're going to have these videos available someday for people that are motivated to cure pain and want to learn the truth and want to use what I've discovered and learned to help others. So, with that said, do we have any questions?
We do have one.
I guess we have one that popped up. Here, Sean.
We have a viewer who wonders, with this kind of surgery, how do you prevent the disc from re-herniating?
All right, a very astute question. Dr. Deuk, with this kind of surgery you just did, there was clearly a hole, right, in the back of the disc there. How do you keep more disc material from squeezing out through that hole that's there that's clearly bigger than it was before? Great question. And the answer is the patient. The patient's activities and basically their activities, their lifting, their bending, twisting, all of that must be restricted. So just kind of in general, when a doctor does surgery, we need our patients to do things after surgery. Those are what are called post-operative instructions, right? For those of you thinking, well, Dr. Deuk, you know, you created a big hole. That's nonsense. You shouldn't have done that. Well, okay. If you've just had surgery and you go drive a car and you crash because of the drugs you've had from surgery and you kill somebody, are you going to blame the doctor for that? Or are you going to blame yourself? Now, the doctor told you and wrote it down, you cannot drive a car until tomorrow. But you choose to disregard the doctor's orders, and you've now harmed yourself and another human being. So the point I'm trying to make is simple. All surgeries, all procedures, all treatments have orders, instructions that come with it. So for the Deuk laser disc repair, our instructions are very simple. As a matter of fact, they're far more simple than any other spine surgery. Do not lift more than 25 pounds for 6 weeks. Do not bend over at the waist to pick something up from the ground. Do not bend at the waist, basically. Now, we give our patients a TLSO back brace called the TLSO stands for thoracolumbar sacral orthosis. And basically, it's one of those things you've seen, like it looks like a clamshell. The old ones were clamshells because they were white and they had the Velcro straps. Well, the newer ones are black, so and they have Velcro. And basically, there's a plastic plate in the front and the back, and it keeps people from bending over. So as long as the instructions are to wear that TLSO brace whenever you're out of bed. So that keeps people from bending over. So the answer is really it's the patient that keeps the disc, another piece of the disc, from herniating out. The patient has to not lift anything heavy and not bend over for 6 weeks. The disc doesn't completely heal, but for 1 year. It takes a year to fully heal a disc. And the reason for that is discs just don't have a lot of blood supply. They do have some blood supply in the outer part of the disc called the outer half of the annulus. However, the inside of the disc has no blood supply at all. So any kind of human tissue or animal tissue that doesn't get blood supply, like blood vessels, it gets its nutrients through diffusion. And the diffusion process is basically the movement of chemicals down a concentration gradient, okay? So for the disc to heal well, it needs blood supply because it needs nutrients. But it doesn't have a blood supply, so it has to rely on the gradual, slow movement of those chemicals like glucose and oxygen to the area of the disc that needs to be healed. All right, we're going to start our broadcast in about 30 minutes at 10:30. So tune in and ask questions. We're going to be talking about the spine and herniated discs and how they can be fixed.